Hey there, I'm Rainy Zimnoch, and in this episode, we're going to talk about how to protect yourself when a seller requests a rent back or possession after the close of escrow. When I work with investors that are looking for flip opportunities, they will do anything they can and be as flexible as possible to buy a deal or buy an opportunity, right? One of those things that is sometimes requested, not often, but sometimes requested by the seller is a potential rent back or, in other words, possession of the property for the seller after the closing. Well, the challenge is now you might be putting yourself at risk as the investor. If you agree to that, to basically close on the property and allow the seller to stay in the house for whatever time that you guys agreed upon, there might be potential issues that might arise. Let me give you maybe a couple scenarios why a seller would like to maybe stay in the property after closing. One reason might be is maybe they're moving across the country and they need the money to get all the moving trucks and get family to come and help and get them to move across the country. Another reason might be is maybe their rental is not ready yet, or maybe it's, you know, 30 days away, or maybe the house they're buying, the closing might not be for another 2 weeks. Those are some of the most common reasons, right? There are more, but those are the most common reasons of why a seller might request a rent back. And a rent back might mean that the seller might pay the new owner actual rent, market rent, or maybe they'll just live there for free for the agreed upon time frame, which usually, you know, might be a week or two, and that's accounted for by the buyer, the investor, already within the purchase price, right? Because they want to be as flexible as possible to get the deal, right, and make it happen. So the challenge now, like I said, how do you protect yourself? And let me kind of give you what could happen, and I'll give you a quick story. So one of my investor clients actually ended up buying a property, and this is an agent in my office that helped this investor actually buy the property. And this is what happened. The seller asked to stay in the property, right, and do a rent back, and they were gonna move out after a month. Well, a month went by, and the tenant slash the seller didn't move out. And guess what? At that situation, tenant laws technically apply. So whatever the tenant laws are in your state, they will actually now, in most cases, apply to that person living in that property. So previous seller is now a tenant, stopped paying you rent. What do you do? Well, they had to give them notice to vacate, right? And in San Diego, it's 60-day notice that's required. Well, they still didn't move out. So the investor had to hire an attorney and go through eviction. 4 months later, I think roughly, and I think he spent $6,000 to $7,000 on everything, right? Attorney fees and holding costs and everything. And finally, he took possession of the house that he's always owned, right? He just couldn't get into his own house that he was waiting to rehab. So how do we avoid that? How do we protect you from that situation, right? Well, that happens at the negotiating table before the closing. That's the only time that you can actually create this protection. So what I suggest is you do, if you're the investor or if you're the realtor representing the investor, is you have to assume the worst case scenario, right? And what I mean by this is exactly what I just explained, that worst case scenario for a client of ours, right? So if I was in this situation, what I would say is like, okay, not a problem, Mr. Seller. I will absolutely grant you that wish of or desire to stay in my property after closing. However, I've had situations before where I've done this and the seller slash new tenant at that point didn't move out and it cost me a lot of money. So I'm going to make sure I protect myself, but I also give you what you wish, right? So in order to protect me, I will need to make sure we hold back $10,000 in escrow from your proceeds. So we're going to release all the proceeds to you except $10,000. And then when you move out, if let's say you agreed upon 30 days, when the seller slash now tenant moves out in 30 days, like agreed upon, they get the $10,000 back, right? Well, not back, they never received it. So they get the $10,000 that was theirs to begin with, right? But they don't get it until they actually move out. And if they would not move out, guess what? You, the investor, you should not get mad. Just expect it. You've planned for that to happen potentially. You have the money to cover your eviction, your attorney, and holding costs. So whatever that amount is, if you think it's $10,000, if it's $15,000, if it's $20,000, do not be afraid to ask for it to make the deal happen. Yes, but protect yourself. And that's how you create a win-win.